Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Geraldine. I'm a geologist. I'm from Ghent University. And currently, I'm doing a PhD project in collaboration with the Department of Archaeology, also from Ghent University. So I'm currently in my first year of my PhD. And in this presentation, I will give some preliminary results about the characterization and patina formation on flint used on prehistoric sites in northwestern Belgium. So I'll first give a short introduction of our PhD project. So flint, the kind of material that was used by prehistoric men to produce stone tools. So in this part, in this first part, we tried to this concerns about the characterization of different flint types. So chemical and structural properties, as well as mineralogy, will be investigated. And since I'm a geologist, I will try to put everything in its geological context, like in what geological layers did they found flint, and how was flint formed, and so on. In the second part, different weathering processes are studied, and since patination and burning are the two types of weathering processes that are mostly found on the artifacts that are found in northwestern Belgium, I will mainly focus in the beginning at these two alterations. So therefore, lab experiments are performed in order to simulate these processes. And this way, we hope to obtain more insights in the development of these weathering features, for example, patination and burning, and to find the relation between what the influence is of the mineralogy and the structure of the flint on the formation of these weathering features. In the third part, microanalysis is performed on these archaeological finds by my colleague Eva, who is also attending this conference. So the aim is to find new registration methods for useware in order to develop a protocol in which we also try to use some 3D methods. So additionally, some experiments are performed using raw flint material we collected, and some archaeological activities are imitating in order to produce microware, and then this experimental microware will be compared to microware that was found on archaeological artifacts. And these replicas we will make, this will also be used in the weathering experiments. So what does these three subjects have in common? Why do we do this? Why is this important? So these weathering processes, they can alter the flint tools and they can confound the interpretation and analysis of useware. And this can be a problem because a lot of the archaeological artifacts found are patinated or are burned at our sites. So that's why it's important to investigate this. And then to see eventually what the influence is of these weathering processes on the preservation of microware traces. So this is what we try to investigate. So our research area is located in northwestern Belgium. So in green you can see the resource, the outcrops which we collected raw material. So the first area is in the Mons Basin, there in Obourg, Armeny, and Spjane we collected material. In the area of Lille we collected in Aubaudet and Bovines. Then we also collected flint pebbles that was found in Vlissingen and was mostly used on the archaeological sites near Antwerp, as well as the Womersen quartzite, which is not a flint type, but it's also a rock type that was commonly used at the prehistoric sites in near Antwerp. So the archaeological sites I will mainly focus on are those of Kerkhoven and Rijen, which are early Mesolithic sites. Then Doel, Veilbroek and Basel, which are final Mesolithic and early Neolithic sites. So I will give a short overview of the methods that I will use in this presentation. So the first one is just a microscopic description of the material we collected, just based on visual properties. Then I will do some optical microscopy, so I made in sections in order to determine the mineralogy and the structure of the flints. I will also perform, currently I'm also doing X-ray fluorescence measurements in order to determine the bulk geochemistry and to see if there are any chemical differences between cortex, so the cortex at the outer rim, mostly found on flint nodules in Cretaceous layers, so between the cortex, the patina, and also the raw material. And then another technique that is less conventional in this type of research is a high-resolution computed tomography, which I will just abbreviate as micro-CT. In this way, we can do a 3D analysis of the surface and of the internal structures of flint material. And this is mostly based on difference in density and on elemental composition. So in this first part of characterization, we just look at the macroscopic hand specimens. So it's kind of the most straightforward technique. So the visible properties is just color, the inclusions, is there a cortex present, or are there any weathering rings present. So on the left hand side you can see here. These are the samples that were collected in the Mons Basin. So number 1 to 3 are three variants of Spien that were found in the geological Spien chalk formation. So we have Harmony collected at the quarry, Harmony. And then we have more light gray and more dark gray variants. And then number 4 and 5, these are a fine grained flint type derived from the Obourg chalk formation, also from the Mons Basin. Then in the area of Lille, we collected at Bovine and Aubaudin. In the Westman Scout, we have Vlissingen, which are all pebbles, very eroded. And then the Warmerson quartzites, which is a fine grained quartz aronite. Then I made thin sections just to determine the mineralogy and the structures that are present in these flint types. So I think it's not a surprise for anyone that the flint is composed of cryptocrystalline quartz. But most often we can also find some other minerals present in these thin sections, such as calcite and chalcedon. And most often fossil remains are also found in these in thin sections. So for example, here you have Obourg, which in the hand specimen was already a very pure-like flint type, which has less inclusions when compared to the three different variants of those of the Spien chalk formations, which have a lot of inclusions. And just to show, these are the ones of the Lille area. The Aubaudin is still in preparation. Vlissingen and Warmerson, you can clearly see the difference between flint and then Warmerson, which is not a flint type, but it's a quartz aronite. So it consists of two main grain size classes, so one smaller fraction and then one coarser fraction. Then the next step in characterization was doing some XRF measurements in order to determine the bulk geochemistry. And these measurements I did in collaboration with the XMI research group, also at Ghent University. So what did I do? I drilled flint samples of 30 millimeters in diameter, and this to estimate the main elements in each type of flint, and in this way try to distinguish already between different types. So I used six different types. These are the results. So on the left hand side you can see the elements that were measured and then the type of flints. So the percentages that you see are not real elemental weight percentages, because therefore we needed to do a calibration and we didn't find a good standard yet. So, but that's what I and Brecht are now working on. But it's already good to see some general trends. So, as already was seen, could be seen in thin section, Obourg with more than 95 signal intensity of silicon is the purest form of flint that I now investigated, when compared to, for example, Spien, which has relatively low signal intensities of silicon. But then on the other hand, this light gray variant has then a higher intensity of calcium content, while Obourg, for example, you don't. Then for the Warmerson quartzite, you can see the higher signal intensities of titanium and of the zircon, and these are associated with the titanium oxides and zircon present in the thin section. And then the, yeah, you can see that Harmonie and Vlissingen have a quite geochemical signature, which is also obvious in intersection, but yeah, I have to say for Vlissingen that the samples are really heterogeneous, so actually I have to measure more to get more of an average for this type of flint. Then I also used another XRF measurement device. It's the micro spectrophotometer to perform an elemental mapping of a section perpendicular to the surface of either, in the case of the Likert variant of Spien, of a patina, a natural patina, and then in the case of Harmonie and Bovine, through the cortex. So I want to do the elemental distribution along this section to see if there's any chemical differences. So I just got these results last week, so it's all preliminary. But there's three elements that had the highest intensities, silicon, calcium and iron, and the trends we could see are as expected. For example, if you look at the silicon signal for the light gray variant of Spien, it's relatively lower than those of Harmonie and Bovine, which was also clear from previous XRF measurements. And then when cortex when this side is detected, you can clearly see that the silicon content decreases for Harmonie and Bovine, which is logical, and the calcium content starts to increase when detecting this cortex. While for the calcium, if you look at the calcium signal of the light gray variant of Spien, this is relatively higher than the others two, which we also expected because we saw this in detection and previous measurements. Then regarding the iron signal, this remains relatively low for all three samples, except for in Bovine, you can see a trend that there's when detecting the cortex, this intensity starts to increase. This is something I'm currently interpreting and probably has something to do with the formation process of this cortex and already an initial relatively high iron signal present in this type of flint. And so the last technique I wanted to I will explain this a little because I don't think everyone is that familiar with micro-CT. With this technique, this provides non-destructive 3D visualization and characterization of objects. So I use the setup at the UGCT. It's the Center for X-ray Tomography at Ghent University. It's a lab-based system, and it consists of an X-ray source, then a sample on a rotation stage over there, and then the detector. So what's happening? So from the X-ray source, X-rays are emitted. So they go through the samples, and they are attenuated when in contact with this material. And this intensity is eventually detected on this detector. So the X-ray transmission is dependent on the material composition, so the effective atomic number, the density, and the thickness. So in the characterization, we try this for characterization. So here just two examples. So I drilled a small flint course, and then I scanned the top. On the left-hand side, you can see a flint having a natural patina, and on the right side, the flint having a cortex. And the gray values, they represent this material density. So for example, the patina and cortex are more porous than the interior material of the flint, as can be seen. And then I hope everyone sees it, but it's a cylinder and I cropped it. So you could see the high density particles coming out, which I visualized in blue, because in white you wouldn't see it very good. These are presumably calcite minerals or other fossils things. And nice thing we can do with this is do a 3D analysis of these all these particles, for example, size measurements, shape measurements, distribution or orientation of these particles, and this we can already use, for example, to distinguish between the light gray variant of Spien and the Harmonie variant of Spien. So in the second part, I'm going to talk about the weathering processes. Just very general, you have chemical alterations, mechanical alterations, and thermal alterations. And for this project, I will first focus on the formation of a white bluish patina, as you can see in the right hand side, and then also on unintentional heat altering. So, and then for the rest of the presentation, will be just on the patination. So the white patina, it's a kind of a weathering rind, and it's caused by natural chemical alteration. So it starts as a bluish film and then become more chalky and white colored over time. And it's and it forms in alkaline environments where there's a high solubility of silica. So in this this is a picture of the simple dissolution model for patina formation processes. This patina develops as a through several dissolution precipitation actions and in order to form this kind of weathering rind. And as the dissolution proceeds, you can have this accumulation layer of several impurities like carbonates or iron oxide or manganese oxides that accumulate at variable depth beneath the weathering rinds. So what I tried to do is to duplicate this in the lab. So I found, after some literature study, I found this technique in which they put flint in warmed sodium hydroxide. So this is what I also tried, and as you can see, I was able to relatively quickly simulate a patina in the lab. So I wanted to look at it at microscopic scale. I want to visualize the development of this process with microcity. So I drilled a small sample of 9 millimeters. I put a heat shrink around it, then put it in a hot solution. The heat shrink was in order to only have the process going through the z-axis and one axis, so you could really see the progress. So I performed this in several cycles of 1.5 hours, and then after each cycle, I scanned it. I hope this movie will work. Yeah, okay, so as you can see, through this procedure, the silicon at the surface dissolves, while calcite, for example, don't and stands out in this stone. Okay, what I then try to do is to compare natural patinas with the ones I produced in the lab. So this is just a CT image of a natural patina compared also with the transection of a natural patina. So you can see that the patina is the upper layer over there. It's less porous than the interior material. And also in transection you can see the differences in chemical composition, for example. Also these having less calcite. Then compared to the one I produced in the lab, as you can see, the thing I did was way too aggressive, but it was more like to see how far could we go with this experiment. So in the future, I'll try to improve this patination procedure, of course. So you can see that the rim is completely deteriorated. Also in the section, you can see that it's completely. But I have to say, this accumulation layer of impurities, it comes back in this experiment, which is a good thing. If you remember previously my dissolution model, in which we also had this accumulation layer of impurities. And then just shortly on, I also tried this with different types of flints, of course. And as you can see, for example, the light gray variant of Spian seems far less resistant against this weathering type when compared to Harmony and Bovine. And also here in these types, you can really see this accumulation layer, which, yeah, we could say that we're not, it's not the most realistic conditions for this patination process, but it's a complicated process, and it's hard to duplicate this, but this is as close as I could come now, so it's already a good thing, I think. And then to summarize, for the characterization, I used the macroscopic description, used some micro-CT, optical microscopy, and X-ray fluorescence regarding the patination experiments. So I will try to patinate flint preserving use wear traces, and then to And then what we're trying to do is to analyze the use where before and after after the patination in order to see the impact of the preservation of this use wear on this weathering technique. Yeah. And then just one more last thing, my colleague Eva, she has a poster. So during the coffee break, if you're interested, you can come to us and ask more questions about this project. In her poster, there's also some results about the microwave analysis with some preliminary results about some 3D techniques we're using. So welcome to that, and thank you for your attention.